So, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the VB Energy pre-conference. My name is Brenna Vermeeren, and I'm a board member of the Association of Public Administration, Vereniging voor Bestuurskunde. And this year, I organized the pre-conference together with Femke Verwest, Mirko Noordegraaf, and Tom Overmans. I will share a slide with you. So this is the sixth edition of the pre-conference, an annual event that the Vereniging voor Bestuurskunde, the VB, organizes together with the Netherlands Institute of Governance. And this year with the title Innovations in the Approaches of Societal Challenges, Connecting Science and Practice. Before I will go to the program of today, a short note. In the chat will appear some practical information for you on the online event. So please have a look at that. Then the program. We will have several speakers today. First, Mirko Noordegraaf, Chairman of the Vereniging voor Bestuurskunde, will introduce today's theme in relation to the ambitions of the VB. He will then give the floor to our keynote speaker, Barbara Regeer. She's an associate professor at VU University in Amsterdam and also affiliated with the Athena Institute. After this keynote, we will have four pitches from people from the policy domain who will share with us some challenges they experience in approaching societal challenges. I will introduce these pitches after the keynote speech. And after the pitches, we will split up into subgroups and we will discuss the pitches in more detail. And after that, we will return to this plenary session to have a joint conclusion of this sixth edition of the VB NIT pre-conference. I wish you all an inspiring morning, and now I would like to give the floor to Mirko Noordegraaf.
Thank you, Brenda. I hope everybody hears me. There are no non-verbal, yeah, I see you know, some nodding. Okay, that's very good. Yeah, Brenda said that Brenda, Femke, Tom, and Mirko organized this pre-conference. It's actually Brenda and Femke organized this pre-conference. And Tom and myself were involved, but on the sideline. So it's really Brenda and Femke who organized this. Yes, from my side as chair of the VB, the Vereniging voor Bestuurskunde, the Dutch Association for Public Administration, a warm welcome to this pre-conference. This is a yearly event, the sixth event already, as Brenda just mentioned. And it's very good to have this event in close cooperation with the NIG. And actually, it's today's NIG's conference day, but we have a close collaboration, and we organize this pre-conference every year. And this really fits, I think, the missions of both these associations, both VB and NIG. But from the VB point of view, I would really like to express that this really fits our mission as the VB, the Dutch Association of Public Administration, because we, as an association, almost for 50 years already, try to connect science to society and vice versa. Or more specifically, we try to connect public administration scholars and scholarship to society, to societal practices in which societal problems are solved through state organizations, public administration processes, etc. We really want to have this, let's say, closer connection. And this is also increasingly linked to other disciplines. So as a VB, we are an association for public administration, but we increasingly want to connect ourselves to other disciplines and also to societal problems, which not only call for a multidisciplinary type of activity, but also for really a societal engagement and commitment. So as a VB, we increasingly try to, let's say, move towards this type of, let's say, orientation, societal problems, multiple disciplines. And I think in most pre-conferences, we had these connections, not only within our own field, but also to other fields and to societal problems. But today's pre-conference is all the more relevant in this respect, because we have not only scholars on board today, but also practitioners. We also have practitioners from, and also scholars from different disciplines, also let's say outside public administration, whatever the borders may be precisely. And we also link today's conversations to societal problems, the circular economy, for example. And this means we have interactive dialogues which connect all these various, let's say, aspects. So problems, scholarship, practitioners, scholars, etc. And this is all the more the case today. Unfortunately, it's also all the more a different pre-conference because of this virtual digital scenery. So I see you, but in a very two-dimensional way. But still, I think the way in which this conference is organized is really not only corona-proof, but also very effective for having this interactive dialogue. Because we have not only a plenary session with the plenary speaker and with pitches, we also have these sub-sessions, as Brenda also already mentioned. And especially in the sub-sessions, really can, let's say, have these interactive dialogues concerning societal problems and making connections between science and society. But before we move towards the sub-sessions, also the pitchers with pitches, who really will elaborate their pitches in the sub-sessions, we now move towards the keynote speaker. And I have the honor to introduce the keynote speaker. Before I do that, one final word from my side, also from this VB perspective. I would like to thank the NIG, Thomas, Noor, Sjors, Esther, for also co-organizing this event. And I really want to express my thanks to Brenda and Femke again for really organizing this event, because without you, this wouldn't have been this effective as it is right now. Then the keynote speaker. We have a very interesting keynote speech, I think, by someone, a colleague from VU University, the Free University Amsterdam. And the keynote speaker is Barbara Regeer. She's an associate professor at the VU, and more specifically at the Athena Institute, which is an institute within the VU context, which really tries to combine science, technology, and society. And I looked for, let's say, some information on Barbara, and I found her LinkedIn page, which is not very difficult nowadays because everybody has LinkedIn pages. But this is a very interesting LinkedIn page because the profile of Barbara is that she is really busy with transdisciplinary strategies for sustainable development and system change. That's a lot. But I think she will have a very interesting, let's say, keynote speech related to this major theme. More selective for today, but it's very interesting, I think, profile you have, Barbara, and I give the floor to you. You have the word.
Thank you very much, Mirko and Brenda, Femke, and everybody who's here. I'm honored that you're all here to share the thinking and the search for complex societal problems and scholarship and professionals and governance and new types of research. So I hope I can contribute to the discussion. I'm going to share my screen now. So please, if it's not working, then someone will let me know, right? Okay, so I was asked to talk about, well, the theme of today. Yeah, it's working. Which was called Societal Challenges in Creating Connections. But I would like to actually move. Sorry, something's popping up. From this WebEx thing. I would like to start with an example and move to India for a little bit in this lecture. And sorry. Yeah. Start with a very concrete example of a quote by someone who is a Nalam worker. And Nalam means wellness in Tamil. And Tamil is the language that is spoken in Tamil Nadu, which is a southern state in India. And the Nalam worker is a community-based healthcare, mental healthcare worker, who has been trained by an organization that we work closely with and we have a PhD program with. To to basically work with the communities on mental health issues. And this is one of her quotes. She says, "A 21-year-old woman's husband committed suicide, leaving her a widow with three young children. She developed depression and suicidal tendencies, which she shared in a community support group meeting. Instead of referring her to the clinic, because there's also a mental health clinic associated with this whole organization that this Nalang worker works for, I spent time with her and discovered that she had grave financial issues due to a loan her husband had taken on a motorbike. The lenders harassed her frequently, and her sister-in-law had taken possession of the motorbike. She did not have money to feed herself and her children." So then this was the case, and what did the Nalang worker do? She said, what she did was she decided to speak to the panchayat leader. Panchayat is a village or a set of villages, who was very supportive. He spoke to the lenders, who waived the loan amount, and to the sister-in-law, who agreed to return the motorbike so it could be sold. And the Nalang worker also helped to enroll the children in school. And this is really significant. After solving these issues, she was doing much better and did not need any medication. And obviously, if you start from a mental health perspective, you might have diagnosed her with depression and started medication. So what I really like about this example is how she really engaged with the family, with the community, and really tried to figure out what the problem is and then try to solve it. But this sounds very logical. If you read this, you think, well, obviously this is what you need to do. So why is this so special? Well, one, she works for a mental health NGO, so you could also expect her to approach this issue from a mental health perspective and, as I said, diagnose and start providing treatment and medication. Secondly, she actually spent time with her before knowing what the appropriate actions would be. And we know that in highly specialized work settings, like we know in the Netherlands and in the West, where financing of treatment is labeled, you can't really spend time upfront and really try to find out what is going on here and what would be a good route to solve this. Thirdly, it's very tailor-made. I'm sure that with the next family or the next person she would meet, it would be totally different, the issues would be not similar, and different solutions would be needed. So there's no protocol blueprint that she can follow or no specific standards. So she needs to be very creative and brave, and in addition to also have a knowledge on depression or mental health issues. So what I would call this approach that she has used, I would call it purpose-oriented versus task-oriented. So if we think about purpose-oriented work, we think about a problem. I've now depicted it as a community, but it could also be deforestation or climate change or nitrogen levels in the soil or any type of complexes are the problem. There's professionals, let's say one professional, somehow needing to deal with it. They use their whatever experience they have, but also they really use their ears and eyes and heart to empathetically try to really embrace the full understanding of what is going on. And then they somehow try to mobilize all kinds of resources, tools, procedures, financial opportunities, funding possibilities, other professionals, other communities to address the problem and the kind of underlying patterns at the core. If we think about task-oriented work, which is on the other end of the spectrum, of course, these are very simplified, kind of idealized sketches. But then we would say, okay, I'm a professional, I work at an institution, I'm trained and I'm provided with all kinds of procedures, protocols, guidelines, standardization, quality control, professionalization, specific type of funding, and then with all this baggage, which is really helpful to me but can also hinder me, I enter I enter communities or problem areas, and I look at the problem from that specific perspective. So it will help me, but it will also hinder me, because it means I see things in a specific way. The professionals could also be us, right? So with our own disciplinary backgrounds, our own concepts and models, we look at the world in a certain way. But it could also be policymakers or healthcare professionals or teachers, anything. So today I really want to reflect on this question of, well, first, we see a convergence of a lot of pleas for pleas, but also approaches and experimentations for this purpose-oriented type of work. So I would like to briefly discuss that. But of course, having seen this difference between purpose-driven and task-driven, there's frictions because we do have our institutions and our baggage and our ways of working, and there are systems which have benefited us to a large extent and but can also hamper. So how to deal with these frictions, and I will give a few examples. And finally, I will reflect briefly on what does it actually mean for governance practices and for research. So that's the outline for today. So what we see over, I think, at least 30, maybe three or four decades already, we see this all kinds of calls and pleas for different ways of approaching complex societal problems. So if we look at research, at science, what we see is this call for more openness out of the ivory tower of science, really look at, not starting with our own concepts, methods, instruments, and theories, but really trying to engage with communities, participatory action research or interactive research. The call for transdisciplinary and transformative research really came up in the 70s of the last century, but kind of transformed, and then it came up again around the millennium change. And over the past decades, responsible research and innovation came in as a term to talk about how research and innovation should be responsive, open, anticipating potential effects of our research and technology and innovation on societal actors, and how to include all these actors upfront in the process of defining research priorities, conducting research, and in that way making our research and innovation much more fit to societal needs, but also higher quality because of all the enrichment of knowledge and diversity of voices and views that could be included. In a way, these are kind of waves, and the terms, you know, they come up and they go, and then new terms are used again. But this whole area of kind of this whole movement of how research can do this has been my own core kind of interest for the past 15 years. But what we also see at the same time, and for some of you, this might be more your expertise, is this idea of, I suppose it started with interactive governance, interactive policymaking, I remember it was called at the time, how can we as policymakers include our stakeholders and citizens far better in all kinds of, well, issues. Newer terms are network governance, the recognition that we need to collaborate with all kinds of different actors in networks. Reflexive governance, what does this actually mean for our structures? What can we learn, and what does it, how do we change along? And this, of course, also counts for the whole R&I system. The whole idea of reflexive governance also would apply for how do we design our R&I policies, for instance. Responsive governance, all these terms might be familiar to you. And in a way, they actually say the same thing. They kind of open the ivory tower and talk about kind of blurring the boundaries between all these different domains. For corporations, entrepreneurs, businesses, it's similar. We have pleas for corporate social responsibility. Sometimes it's greenwashing, sometimes it's not. Circular economy, the donut economy, how can we include a wider set of values besides profit values into our economy in such a way that those values are accommodated at the same time, and we create these win-win situations. This is, of course, also simplified because I'm now pretending that the world exists of scientists, business people, government, and NGOs, which of course is not true. So there's media, which has a very big role next to NGOs. There's also CSOs. There's many, many people. So the idea is that around certain complex societal problems, I think all these different, please actually say, let's not do this for everything, but let's identify when we are dealing with a persistent problem, an unstructured problem, a problem that does involve multiple actors at multiple levels, where people do not agree about a direction, where it's not really clear what knowledge we need. These types of wicked problems, they would require co-creative, responsive, multi-stakeholder approaches where the orientation is towards the purpose. What would we like to achieve with it, rather than starting fully from the professionalized procedures that we have already developed. Because the idea is that in these complex situations, we need to probe, we need to try out stuff. We can't just analyze, make a plan and execute. It doesn't work for these complex situations. And this analysis that from this complexity, it follows that these processes should be more iterative, more interactive, more co-creative with multiple stakeholders. They are the same from whichever domain you start. So that's why I call it a convergence of kind of pleas of for new approaches, but also the characteristics of these approaches are really quite similar. Of course, we can talk about all kinds of details and differences, but this is the bigger story. So imagine there's an issue that you work on, probably something that you work on yourself might be labeled as an unstructured, wicked, or complex or persistent problem. You might be a researcher working on it. You might be a policymaker working on it. You know you need each other. You know you need to collaborate. But you also know that we all have our home base. We all have our baggage, our tools, our ways of looking that we bring to it. So in transition theory, this would be depicted as follows. So actors together create practices whilst practicing. But at the same time, they create a culture with all kinds of ideas about what is good and what isn't, and norms and values, but also structures. So there's this great intertwinement between these kind of harder to change cultures and structures, which really kind of determine the freedoms that we have in kind of changing our practices as professionals and as actors, and the practices themselves. So there's this iteration, and obviously this is how our practices and our routines get shaped and function. But if we want to change them, it makes it really hard. So of course there's now actors in this green kind of thing. But if we would also want to collaborate with people from other organizations, other disciplines, other schools of thoughts, then you can see that they also have their own cultures and structures behind them. So I would like to give a very concrete example of where we would see this friction between a new kind of practice and a specific part of a system. This picture that we see here is called Speaksy. It's a technology that was developed by a young IT entrepreneur who was raised by two deaf parents, and he was very committed to the idea that in order to participate fully in society and in work, there need to be better solutions than always needing an interpreter with you. So he developed this kind of synchronized transcription tool that would actually really does work in meetings. So people wear these little microphones, and then in different color codes, it comes up 1 second later. After people speak. But basically this was experimented with in a bank and at the police in different offices, and it was really successful, and this was part of a bigger program, which I will turn to in a minute. But what we see is when it comes to kind of the upscaling, because in the end, if something works successfully and the whole idea is to increase participation of people with working disabilities in the workforce, then barriers are hit. So one of them was the following. Funding of sign language interpreters happens through the employment agency in the Netherlands, because they basically have a whole funding scheme. You apply for it, you get so many hours or weeks of sign language interpreter that you can use as a deaf person every year. So then obviously it made sense if this would come in addition to the sign language interpreter to fund it from the same thing. Unfortunately, this agency says it doesn't work like that because we see it as a hearing aid, and a hearing aid should be funded by the health insurance. I will come back to solutions later, but this is a problem where you can see that it's hard for a specific group of people in a practice to change because the actual barrier is at system level. Another example is to do with a child-centered youth protection approach that was developed here in Amsterdam, where basically they were asked to redesign their working method if they would really work from a child-centered perspective. And they figured out basically everything they do in their processes with clients. They made a pile, they brought it all notes, made a pile of what does contribute to keeping this child safe and what doesn't. And then they came to the very depressing conclusion that 70% of their work actually does not contribute to keeping the child safe because it's to do with all kinds of formalities and bureaucracy and administrative tasks. So, and only 30% directly contributed to the child's safety. So they then, the professionals themselves, decided to redesign their practice, supported by the whole organization. But what we see is, I can give you one example. For instance, the way a report is built, like a client file of every client, differs per organization. And in child care and youth protection, a lot of different organizations are involved that all either provide care or it's the legal system, the judges that need to decide about a certain measure, legal measure. And they all have their own requirements of how this should be registered. So those caseworkers, they are just filling out forms all the time. And that would not actually be considered, valuable work for the child safety. So that's an example of why in the old working method, the pile is so high. I will also come back to the solutions in a minute. So what are different potential strategies to deal with these frictions? And I will give three examples at different levels. One at the professional level, the second at an organizational level, and the third at the regime level. The first, I go back to the NALAM worker that I started with. What we have seen is what those NALAM workers do, they act as boundary spanners. They are able to somehow make the connection between, for instance, governmental officials and a family. In this case, it was the panchayat leader. For all kinds of reasons, like for instance, can these people have a disability allowance card? No, says the panchayat leader, because mental health is not a disability. And then they can kind of help make this happen and explain how mental health does actually lead to disabilities. But also between the families and communities, between families and mental health professionals. What I found so interesting is that they said we somehow need to integrate the Western mental health perspective of professionals and the more indigenous ideas about what a mental health problem is of the communities. And we just marry the two. We just mix the two. We explain things in terms of indigenous ideas rather than in terms of biomedical processes. So they really are boundary spanners. That's one way to deal with these different systems that are around us and that might not always be conducive. Another example that we've seen is that in organizations, for instance, the Youth Protection Agency in Amsterdam, they have a very solid escalation process, which basically means one of the things that we did with the professionals was ask them, if you now look at the new work method and you also look at what you used to do, where do you feel you would be defaulting into your own working methods? And they actually gave this example of the forms, because they say if a child needs to be placed somewhere for a weekend and it's Friday evening and the other organization says, fill in this form, I will fill in the form, even though I'm not supposed to, because what I'm supposed to do is, if another organization tells me to fill in the form, I need to tell them, no, I'm not going to do it because it's not purpose-driven, it does not contribute to the child's safety. So I'm not doing it and you still need to help me. Then there's this conflict between the two professionals. If they aren't able to solve it, the two managers go and fight together. If they can't do it, then the directors and then the board. And this is how it continues. And they've done this really systematically. So within the organization, there's all kinds of processes to make sure that all these issues, they call them issues, are on the table and discussed. And especially when they go to higher levels, they are changed structurally. So then in that way, the whole kind of context of the organization changes along. That's one, that's second example. Third example of how to deal with frictions is where forums are created at regime level. So in transition theory, this would be called transition arena. So with the SpeakSea example, what happened was there's this coalition for technology and inclusion with people from the relevant ministries, people from this employment agency, people from employers and clients as well. And they are the ones who said, let's try out all kinds of different technologies that could help people get employment. SpeakSea is one of them. They had about 8 more other technologies that we helped evaluate. And then whenever barriers were encountered within the pilots, they would be brought to this coalition level. And this is one of the things that we did, but also we had our own steering board, which we also selected carefully to make sure that we had interesting regime players there. And in that way, we try to really make that kind of link between system barriers experienced at the ground level and government or health insurance that could help and change it. So one example is we contributed to an article in the Financieel Dagblad, financial newspaper in Netherlands, which came out last week, to actually talk about this fact that it's actually not happening. This is actually the developer of SpeakSea. This is one thing that helps, but also other people in our own steering board are now approaching the members of parliament. But of course, everybody who sits in these boards says, we've got to solve this. They go to their boss, get their bosses together, write all kinds of things. Unfortunately, we haven't reached a breakthrough yet here, but it's an example of how these things happen. So what does this mean for governance practices? As I said, public administration and policy sciences is not my expertise, but what I've seen, and I think that might be interesting to share, is that there is this immersion of what I would call systemic policy instruments. So rather than rules and regulations, laws, financial instruments, communicative instruments, there is this other kind of set of policy instruments, which we would call systemic instruments. And examples are those programs, the one that I just gave as an example, this Coalition for Technology and Inclusion, where people from government research and practice, so entrepreneurs and clients, all sit together at regime level, but also at practice level. And there is experimentation, there is explicit attention for taking away barriers. And that's a kind of setup that we see more often. So another example, and I know that the project leader is here today also, Olga Kallis, so some of you will also go to that workshop, which is the inter-authority program on rural vital countryside in the Netherlands, which has a similar structure. 15 areas in the Netherlands have been selected. And in these areas, people experiment with what does it actually mean, vibrant countryside? And it's a lot to do with economy, ecology, and society, and how to bring these all together with all the known difficulties and tensions, for instance, between farmers and nature, and how to resolve these. And any system barrier that they experience are then brought to other levels of regime players, and in a very detailed way, the puzzles are made and the strategies are developed to see how this structure can be more supportive for this development. And similarly, the youth protection example. So there's a big program by the two different ministries, and there are different pilots happened. We were the ones that evaluate. Actually, in all of them, we are involved in evaluating them. And same thing. So we find different things that are relevant in terms of, for instance, laws, and then have discussions at ministerial level about how to change them. So what we see, what are the important aspects of these systemic policy instruments? Creating connections and alignment, experimentation, connecting those multiple levels, stimulate vision development, developing new language and discourses. And of course, there are temporaries, but it's interesting to see the mechanisms that happen within these programs and how they could be made more structured. I see that I'm going to have to draw it to a close in not too long, so I'm moving towards the end. So just seeing how they move from the inside to the outside, in this case with the families, we use this picture where basically it's all about, you know, how can we keep those children safe and the different professionals with their tools and mechanisms, and all kinds of barriers were identified at these different levels, and especially also between organizations working together. So this is what I just explained, but it doesn't actually matter what the topic is, if it's about farmers and how they can deal with both security for continuity of their business in terms of income, as well as protecting environment and nature, then it's the same thing. We then need to figure out, but what does it mean for the types of support structures that we can build around this? So the move is from the inside out. It does, of course, give questions of what kinds of control mechanisms fit this. And this is just one last thing that I would like to give as an example. I read this article about 15 years ago, maybe even longer, where they spoke about this traffic junction near a school. And basically, they had taken away all the different signs and stripes and everything, and the situation had become, and even the gate, the heck, the kind of board, the thing protecting your children from running to the street, that also taken away that. So children were actually running on the streets and it had become safer. And I thought it was an interesting metaphor. If we think about this highly specialized world that we live in with all its advantages, we see there's people that, this of course are made up, I don't really know how that works in traffic things, but basically there's painters, they need to be checked and controlled, then there's someone who's supervisors, and then there's another person, and there's all these people working together, or not working together, and they're painting, and there's all kinds of mechanisms behind to make sure that they do the right thing, they're up to date, they work evidence-based, but we can see that it soon becomes very, very complicated, and maybe we discover, oh, there's two painters, maybe they could work together and paint all at the same time, but those are all optimizations of really quite a complicated system that might not need to be as complicated. Whereas in the idea of there's nothing, no guidance, and people just have to look out for themselves because they have the same interest, that makes the example easy, because they want to cross the street safely and not harm anyone else. There we see that people kind of, everybody there on this crossing has the same responsibility. We don't want accidents to happen, and we share that responsibility, and it makes it easier. This is not a plea for self-organized teams, but it's more a plea for we need to somehow rethink the systems that we have built up and to see what is still needed and what isn't. You might all be familiar with this diagram by Martijn van der Steen and others of the NSOB in the Netherlands. What I want to focus on is not as much the idea between what we have seen, laws and regulations, the public management versus collaborative and responsive government, but more about what this means in terms of the control mechanisms. In terms of all these pleas, we see people saying we should be really careful with our KPIs. If we are really to be reflective practitioners and if the systems are to support us, what we need is meaningful measures. We use the term measures as a boundary object because a measure, an indicator, seems like a KPI, but what people say it means is, if I'm a professional and I need to fill in forms or fill out checklists or all those kinds of systems that will kind of somehow show my performance, it needs to help me reflect, it needs to help me in my interaction with the community as well. And rather than checks and balances. What we need is these reflective mechanisms, ways that help us make the changes that are needed at system level. This is a bit abstract, so it'd be interesting to talk more in detail about this. Finally, what we see is it's not enough to develop visions to see how we can create win-win situations to kind of have this idea of a vibrant countryside or safe children or employed people with disabilities. We need to change practices. And this means actually doing it, trying it out, and then making a connection with these barriers. And we don't really know which route beforehand. So it means what it means in terms of reflective mechanisms also that, for instance, in the funding, we are flexible. We don't need a 3-year plan because we need to be able to probe and experiment and make changes along the way. What does it mean for research practices? I think I've already given a few examples. Rather than only studying, understanding, and offer practical theory, when we observe these new types of collaborations, we may also be the researchers that participate and navigate between science and society as an expert, for instance, an environmental expert or a youth care expert. But we may also start to design interfaces, facilitate interactions, be a change agent. For instance, by bringing people together, this is the SPIXI project, the NALAM project, I already gave that example. The woman on the right has now finished her PhD by actually also studying and doing action research, by seeing how media can work. But mostly, and this is where I would like to end, it's not as much the tools and the interventions and the things that we do as researchers, it's also, and as professionals, I think this is all the same for all of us here around in this room today. And it's not about our brains, it's about what we see, what we hear, and how we are able to also open our hearts to create more holistic pictures. And we need to be creative and brave, like our NALAM worker that I started with. Here, this is where I would like to end.
Thank you, Barbara. Can you stop? Yes, yeah, thank you. Okay, thank you for your presentation. A nice overview of creating connections. And I think enough food for thought. We will now link it to some challenges people within the policy domain experience. And therefore, we have 4 pitches, and we can discuss the content of your keynotes within more detail within these sub-sessions. I will now briefly introduce the 4 pitches to you, all 4 of them, and then they will present their pitch in a row. So, I have to change something. Okay, we have 4 pitches today. The first pitcher is Marieke Goré. She's working at the Human Environment and Transport Inspectorate, and she will be the first pitcher. Then we have Kim Hermans, and she's working at the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate. Our third pitcher will be Olga van Kallis. She works on a joint initiative of the Interprovincial Association, the Ministry of Agriculture, Nature and Food Quality, the Association of Dutch Municipalities and the Union of Water Boards. And our fourth pitcher is Marieke Spijkerboer. She's working at the Ministry of Infrastructure and Water Management. So let's start with the first pitch. Marieke, the floor, Marieke Goré, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I want to start my pitch with a picture on the left. A number of trains parked at a depot somewhere in the Netherlands, which look brand new to us. What happened? The train between Amsterdam and Brussels is an important connection for us, especially for our civil servants. The Dutch government therefore wanted a high-speed connection on that track. And in 24, we ordered our first high-speed trains for that. At the end of 2012, the first VIRA trains started their journey between Amsterdam and Brussels, and that was 2 years too late. However, in the beginning of 2013, after hardly 5 months of service, all the trains, all the recently bought high-speed VIRA trains were removed from service. They didn't function as we thought they would function. And this literally left the traveler in the cold. This called for a parliamentary inquiry. And one of the conclusions of this parliamentary inquiry was that it came out in 2015, was that our supervision, the supervision of the Human Environment and Transport Inspectorate, focused too much on paper trails and compliance and formal rules, and did not account for real life risks, and didn't pick up the signals that we found in practice. And this for us was one of the signals that we had to follow a new course. This new course is based on 4 pillars. First, we want to work more risk-based, and we select our priorities more based on field-wide risk assessment of real risks for real society. We want to be more reflective. We want to look more beyond compliance and make, for instance, senior reports to inform responsible ministers or the public about risks we find, for instance, like the VIRA risk and other relevant points we find during our work. Maybe there are rules that have undesirable side effects, then we have to mention that, we think. We want to work more efficient. At this moment, we are improving our licensing processes. And last but certainly not least, we want to work more information-based and more transparent. What does this mean for us in practice? We are more working and thinking now at the moment in integral programs. This means that in these programs, we want to make better use of data, of available data. That can be our own data, but also data collected by others. We want to use them for our risk assessment, but maybe also for our better aiming our inspections. We have, as I mentioned, more integral programs, focusing more on a societal risk instead of a special regulation, a special norm, etc. And these integral programs focus on strategic goals, such as less compliance, but things as less victims of Legionella, less unnecessary energy use, less emissions of greenhouse gases, that kind of goals we want to aim our program on. So it's a little bit like Barbara mentioned, we want to work more purpose-oriented instead of task-oriented. That's really, really a challenge, I can assure you. How do we try to achieve that? One of the things that are an important basis of our programs is the intervention logic chain. You see it here on the left. It goes from input to outcome. And it is the basis of all our integral programs. We start at the input, number of people, number of inspectors we can use in the program. The throughput, that is the things we actually do, our actions, our interventions, like inspections, but also maybe data research, system checks, talks with target groups. We want to focus a little bit on other interventions instead of the standard intervention, doing more inspections. This will lead to a certain output, for instance, a number of inspections, a signaling report, maybe a cooperation agreement with our European partners, the things we deliver. And then we come to our outcome, and that's the real challenge. We want to achieve something that can be seen also in the outside world, for instance, a change of behavior in our target group. More awareness, our target group following rules more, etc. And last but certainly not least, we want to focus a little bit more on the societal goals. We want to see that by doing our work, we see safer transport, cleaner ships, a better environment. And our challenge now at the moment is to be accountable and transparent, as you see in the last bullet, based more on this outcome and not only on the output, because the output we can count easily. We know exactly how much inspections we did, but what is the effect of these inspections? That is a little bit more difficult to show. How can we do, and our challenge is, how can we do that? How can we be more transparent about our outcome within our role as a supervisor? How can we go beyond reporting on figures of non-compliance and ticking of checkboxes, as you see here in the picture, and focusing more on the effect, for instance, here, less illegal trade in refrigerants with a very high global warming potential, which is not a very good idea for our climate problem. Now, partly this is a methodological challenge. The relation between our intervention and this final outcome is not always easy to make. We have causality issues. We mainly should use qualitative methods instead of counting quantitative. But even more challenging is the strategical choice. Are we comfortable leaving our own compliance area? And will policymakers accept it when we move a little bit into their area, into their territory? And I liked very much what Barbara said. I think it will ask something from us in reaching out, crossing borders, doing it not on our own, and also have some room for pilots and experiments. It will mean something for our role and possible actions. And yes, our main question to you will be, I think, how can we do this? How can we let the outside world in? How can we experiment a bit more? And how can we involve all those other stakeholders? Because we are very used to doing it on our own. That concludes my challenge.
Hi, my name is Kim Hammond. I'm from the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate Policy, and I'm working on the monitoring and evaluation of the climate policy. First of all, I will tell something about what we already did with monitoring and evaluation, and then I will formulate the challenge for next year. And I asked a friend of mine, an artist, to make a nice picture of my challenge, so it will help us to tell about this challenge. As you know, we have an ambitious target with climate policy, a reduction of the greenhouse gas emission with 49% in 2030 and reaching climate neutrality by 2050. To monitor the progress of the climate policy, the first year of our project, we developed a monitor. The first version of this monitor is sent to the Parliament 2 weeks ago. And with this instrument, we monitor the progress in the 5 sectors of the climate policy. This means industry, electricity, mobility, agriculture and land use, and built environment. And you see this in top of the picture, all these 5 sectors. And different ministries are responsible for these sectors. So we are working together in an interdepartmental project group in which the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate Policy is responsible for the coordination. We monitor the sectors on 4 levels. You see this on the left of the picture. So first, we monitor the realization of the agreements of climate policy and the policy instruments. And second, we monitor more the level of the system. So we investigate if the basic or preconditioned that are necessary for the transition are realized. For example, a low cost price of sustainable techniques or support by citizens for climate measures. And third, we look for the change in the behavior of the different target groups like citizens, house owners, companies, or industries. And fourth, we look at the end at the results and effects of the policy instruments, for example, the amount of electrical cars that are sold. And based on these four levels, we formulate a policy theory for every sector. And combining these policy theories will hopefully enable us to develop an integral theory on climate policy. And last year, we also worked on an evaluation structure and a plan for an integral evaluation in 2024. And you see this on the right of the picture. We have to evaluate the climate policy that is formulated in the so-called climate plan that was defined in 2019. We evaluate this plan every 5 years. The first thing we did this year was to inventorize the instrument evaluations that are already planned by the different concerned ministries. And these evaluations of the instrument were the starting point of an interdepartmental strategic evaluation agenda. And it will tell us already something about the effectivity and efficiency of the policy. But next year, we also have to formulate intersectional questions that we want to answer in the evaluation, and that's more on the level of the climate system as a whole. In the integral evaluation, we want to focus on the most relevant instruments and show the relations or the coherence between the sectors and the instruments. And we want to find the blind spots. You see this in the middle of the picture, the aspects of the climate policy that which we have no or not enough knowledge about and which are essential for the realization of the climate goals. So the challenge that I want to submit to this conference is the question how we can achieve an integral policy theory of the climate policy in which we can clarify the coherence between the sectors and the instruments, and how we can formulate together with the concerned ministries that have a responsibility for a specific sector, how can we formulate the intersectional questions that the evaluation has to address? Or is the climate policy too complex to see it from an integral perspective? What has to be the scope of the evaluation if we want to say something about the effectivity of efficiency of the climate policy? And what is possible regarding the complexity of this multi-actor and society challenge? So what is the best we can do, and what, especially, how do we get there? So I'm looking forward to hear your contribution and your insights about this topic in the session ahead. Thank you.
Okay. I'm Olga van Kallis, Program Manager of the Intergovernmental Program Vital Countryside. Barbara already gave a little impression. I really enjoy meeting you all here online and presenting you one of my many struggles. First, something about the program itself. The Netherlands is facing major challenges in the areas of food production, climate change, water quality, biodiversity, and changing landscapes. These challenges require a coherent region-specific approach, an approach in which administrative layers work together with farmers, civil society, and corporations. That's why the Ministry of Agriculture, Nature and Food Quality, provinces, municipalities, and water boards have joined forces and started in 2018 this intergovernmental program. On their own, they can't handle these complex challenges. These four have the ambition to work as one government on an economically vital, livable, and ecologically sustainable countryside. And we started in 15 promising areas. These regions are in the lead of their own program regarding the most urgent challenges they want to tackle, the way in which they want to organize and finance them, and how they want to make synergy between the sectoral tasks. And is not managed top-down from The Hague. A national intergovernmental program supports the 15 areas. In order to learn and develop together on this experimental approach, we are evaluating our program in an innovative way.
by the Netherlands Environmental Assessment Agency and the Athena Institute by Barbara. They conduct a learning evaluation. We do not want retrospective testing results, but we learn, getting reflection and getting an evaluation feedback on our approach during our work in progress at both national and regional level. And we have been on the road for 3 years now, and the national support program will end May 2021, next year. It does not stop for the 15 regions. They are continuing to implement their plans. A lot has been set in motion. The program provides a lot of energy, and the parties are increasingly able to find each other and work together in the regions. But in that sense, the program remains an outboard motor that brings a lot of speed in a new way of working, and it's still an exotic program that is organized alongside existing organizations by the so-called believers. Working as one government and looking for synergy in the sectoral approaches is not yet commonplace. How do I get intergovernmental collaboration and purpose-driven work secured in these organizations while governments are designed to make sectoral policy? Is there room for another way of working? A question for me to be answered next year: should this outboard motor be continued, or will the 15 regions be strong enough to continue on their own, and or will they fall back in business as usual? What would you do? I hope to hear some advice from you later on. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Marieke Spijkboer. I'm from the Department of the Infrastructure and Water Management. Can you give me the next slide, please? Yes. Well, circular economy. What is a circular economy? In a circular economy, products and materials are reused and production chains are redesigned to minimize waste and maximize the value of resources. The idea of a circular economy has many different aspects, all looking towards being more careful with raw materials and natural resources. This includes more and new ways of recycling, but also a change in designing, manufacturing, and using products to limit the use of raw materials. It's a very important, but also very complex policy field. It's about a system change and asks for new partnerships, new business models, and new mindset. It touches on several other policy fields and affects different government bodies, businesses, organizations, and citizens. A broad support among all these actors are important to successfully complete the transition. Therefore, in 2017, we arranged that 180 parties signed the Raw Materials Agreement, which contains agreements between the national government and other parties about measures to accelerate the transition to the circular economy. Currently, over 400 organizations signed this agreement. We arranged also that there are 5 transition agendas. They are focusing on 5 sectors, biomass and food, plastics, manufacturing industry, construction sector, and the consumer goods. They all work together to achieve that we are in 2050 have a circular economy in the Netherlands. What makes this very complex? Above, we have to work with so many stakeholders, is that the goal of being 100% circular is not clear yet. What do we want to achieve exactly, and how are we moving towards these ambitions? many aspects are still uncertain. We don't know yet what the best policy instruments are and want to deploy them. We also don't know what the exact impact is of the instrument we have put in place. Could you please show the next sheet, please? We need science to be able to make new policy and determine where we want to go. Fortunately, we are gradually provided with scientific insight from a monitoring program we put in place, and these insights may change during time. As you might understand, making circular economy policy cannot be done in the classic way. It concerns a new way of making policy more integral, more flexible, and together with all these partners around us, including these scientific institutes. Because how do you make policy when everything is moving? How do you keep taking the right steps? And it concerns a new way of monitoring and evaluation. We need a learning and reflexive monitoring, and this must be properly implemented. In my session, I will show you how we try to bring structure to an area in which everything is moving. I will provide insight into how we make policy, show you how we approach its monitoring, and I'll provide some dilemmas we encounter between policy and science when working together. I hope to see you in my breakout session.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, all four of you, for your openness in sharing with us the challenges you all encounter in tackling these societal issues. We have seen challenges on various societal themes, and also on challenges that are located at different levels, for example, individual, departmental, interdepartmental. We will now split up into subgroups to discuss these challenges in more detail. You can accept the invitation that will appear on your screen within a few seconds. And after 45 minutes, you will automatically return to this plenary session. So I wish you all an inspiring sub session. I'll see you soon. Okay. Yes, welcome back to this plenary session. I think we've managed to get you all back to this plenary session. Hopefully you had all an inspiring breakout session, and we are heading towards an end of this meeting. And for that, I want to ask the pitchers to very, very shortly share their eye-opener or most important insight from the subsession with us. And I want to ask Marieke Goré to do this now.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the inspiring session. I heard a lot of ideas from different angles, different viewpoints. The one that I'm really going to take away, I think, is one of our challenges is how to involve stakeholders outside the inspection and to work together to get a real solution to the problem. And one of the ideas was when we report about our findings, we mostly report on are people following the rules? We have very strict conclusions. And maybe in our report, we should focus also a little bit more on the meaning behind the rules, but also on the dilemmas. So the dilemmas we as an inspection are facing when we are confronted with a certain situation. And when you share a dilemma, you invite others more to think with you to a solution. So maybe that's an open hand in doing it together more.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Kim, can you share what else your eye-opener or most important insight?
Yeah, thank you. It was a very inspiring session. I have two conclusions from the session. First, I think we also have to still keep in mind the ultimate goal, so the reduction of the greenhouse gas emission. We discovered, I already knew, of course, but that the monitor is more focused on the output, and we have to come to the outcome, this ultimate goal. And we are already working on put this together, the output and the outcome. But that was one of the conclusions that we have to do that. And the second conclusion was that this is more focused on the content, on the goal. But we also need to put more attention to the process where we are in. So we're now working for only 1 year together with the department. But we have to evaluate the process, how we are doing it now, to put it more in a learning environment, to learn from each other in the process, and to get a better product at the end, a better evaluation plan. So this one, maybe we have to change the structure or to improve the structure. Better to make it more a shared responsibility and a more supported plan for the evaluation.
Okay, thank you. Tom, you will reflect on the third session. Je geluid is uit, Tom.
This would work. Olga asked me to reflect a bit, and I think we had a great discussion with a struggling program manager, and we discussed basically one pressing challenge that is how to deal as a program manager, how to incorporate the ambitions that the program has to in the organizations involved when ending the program. And I think Olga has reformulated two lessons for herself. One is the program has to develop from generating impetus for the areas and for the rural areas in the Netherlands, more to safeguarding the ambitions of the program. And a second lesson is to focus more on removing barriers so that the program can stop at any time. And now, if the program stops now, then the conclusion was that all the investments that have been done would be, to some extent, be for nothing, and that would be very sorry for everyone's activities and investments. So that's the main lessons from our session.
Okay, thank you. And Marieke Spijkerbroek.
Yes, in the last one, we had a very good session, a small one, but a good one. I think for me, the most important is that it's not only important to be to share the promise, what do you want to achieve, but it's also very important to share the process you want to follow to get to the goals you set. And the thing I want to start with next year or maybe year after is to have talks with all the stakeholders who wants to join us to tell us about the frictions they experience, so we can learn about what we have to change or where the and we can learn from each other, because it's both ways probably about how we want to do the things and what's important to change in our policy. So that's what we have learned.
Okay, nice, thank you. Barbara, would you like to reflect on this from your keynote very shortly?
Yes. Yes, of course, I would like to reflect. So the first thing I'd like to say is that for each of the pitches, I thought each of the challenges were really recognizable in terms of, well, those differences, they are all quite clear. So each of the projects had this specific purpose, this specific, and sometimes really specific, with some much percent of reduction of something in a specific year, sometimes a little bit more ambiguous. But basically, if you talk about purpose-oriented work, that's really clear that those programs are these kinds of systemic policy instruments where you do try to create an impetus for change. You try to connect different actors with each other. You try to figure out why things are working or not. But what I also heard is we know that it's difficult because collaboration is hard, because people do have different ideas, different frames of reference, different accountability mechanisms, different time horizons, different realities, basically. And so how do we know, how can we actually steer? Like, where are the little knobs to turn? And it's a huge challenge. And one of the characteristics, I think, of these types of big systemic policy instruments, that there is not one person that can actually oversee the whole thing. So it does mean diving in and diving out, or zooming in and zooming out, and together with people, try to make sense of it together whilst you walk the road, as it were. And it also means that in terms of monitoring and research, and researchers or policy evaluators that are involved, they are part of that process as well. And I think So that's for any of us who are researchers. How can we do that? Because we don't know that it will give us nice publishable knowledge, whereas our accountability mechanisms are that, you know, we need to be able to publish our findings. That's one thing. But also, we might have a nice monitoring tool in our on our shelf that we would like to use, but that might not be applicable at all. It's really sunny here in Amsterdam, as you can see. It might not be applicable at all to the problem at hand. So are we able to let go of the types of tools and methodologies that we're used to using, and what kinds of uncertainties will we face, and how can we deal with these uncertainties? And what I really liked about Marieke, the first Marieke, where you said my eye opener is that we should share our dilemmas, and I think also in our discussion that we had with the other Marieke, it also actually came to that point, like, we maybe not only from all the involved stakeholders try to find out what kinds of frictions they experience, but every single person. So also, if you are this change agent, this transition manager, or however you would call it, you have all kinds of dilemmas about wanting to go somewhere but not really knowing how to get there, about different time horizons, about not having the overview but still needing to make steps. So all these dilemmas need to be on the table. And what I would like to emphasize, and it might be, I don't really know, we didn't really discuss this, but I think it only works if you're totally honest to yourself also about your insecurities, and if you can really put yourself on the table, because the more open you are, and it might be like really embarrassing things, like, you know, really your ego playing a big role, but of course you don't want to have that because you just want to be this really nice collaborative person that, you know, is listening to everybody. But you might not be sometimes, or you might be insecure because you feel intimidated by a particular actor. So I think that the deeper you can go in yourself to really try to figure out why you are finding something difficult, the more honest you are about that, then the more honest people are, the more able other people are also to kind of dive into their own reflections. This is really individual. So this is really about how can everybody be, everybody that you involve, how can they be the best instrument for this change themselves as a person? And so that's one thing. Then, of course, there's the other thing also, which is you're in this complicated playing field and you need to turn on knobs and you need to take decisions and you need to steer it in a particular way, and that's more the strategic and the kind of, but that I think you do with everybody who has reached this kind of honesty and sharing. Maybe this sounds all very fake, but this is really what I believe. To also be able to always ask other people, like, I'm really doubting whether we should do this or that, but what can you help me think? Like, what would you do? Or how would that be for you? I'm not only talking to you, I'm also talking to other people. And how would it be for everybody if we would take this decision? Where would the frictions come and how can we resolve them? The last thing I would like to say is, if you are able to get much more insight into these frictions, into what is at play for the different stakeholders, it will give you lots of opportunities to create win-win situations. But you can only do that by going much more to the core. Like, why is it difficult for a knowledge institution to deliver timely knowledge? You know, because they would say, we need a year to do the research and to find out, and then we put it all in our models, and then we come with all this data. But why is it really that it's hard to come up with more timely knowledge and to kind of jump into the process and create the knowledge whilst collaborating together? These questions, they need exploring also.
Okay.
I think that's what I would like to add.
Thank you very much for your reflection. we are running a bit out of time, so and you need time to lunch before all your appointments this afternoon. So, as Vereniging voor Bestuurskunde, Dutch Association of Public Administration, it was our aim to exchange experiences and insight from science and from practice in approaching various societal challenges. This would not have been possible without the input from all of you, so thank you very much for attending this meeting. Before I will thank the speakers, I will thank some people that were very helpful behind the scenes, and that are Esther from NIG, Wilma from the VB, and Daniel from HD Rent. And of course, I want to thank the speakers of today. I would like to thank Barbara Regeer for the keynote speech. And I would like to thank Marike, Olga, Kim, and Marike for sharing your experiences. To express our appreciation, you will find a small gift in your mailbox on behalf of the VB. And now I would like to close this session by asking if you all want to turn on your microphone. And give a big round of applause for today's speaker, and have a nice day. Thank you.